Thank you for the song. Beautiful message. Because that's what we're here for, to give thanks to God. Isn't that right? Has he not been good to us all week, all of our lives? Lately I've been under attack by him. He's been reminding me. Because I told him, I said, Lord, reveal to me anything that stands between you and me. Sometimes when you say that, you don't know what you're asking for. Because he starts opening this stuff that you forgot about a long time ago. And you have to say, wow, I did do that, didn't I? So we have to be doing that, though. We have to be thanking him by wanting to be with him always. I'm going to ask you to pray with me as we begin our message. Father in heaven, once again, we come before you humbly, desiring your divine intervention, knowing that there is nothing in us that can represent holiness except you give it to us. And today, Father, this speaker asks for purity of heart to possess your word, power to present your word. I pray for the Holy Spirit that your word will reach the hearts of your people and inspire them unto greatness. Father, thank you for hearing and answering this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. The scripture reading is telling us about a warfare between Satan and God's church. And as you will see, we're going through a series on the pillars of our faith. And today we're going to talk about the spirit of prophecy. The spirit of prophecy. In Revelation chapter 12, which was read, we see a warfare between Satan and the church. The woman spoken of represents God's church. He's always likened his church unto a delicate and comely woman. She is the one that he will marry when the bridegroom cometh. The bridegroom is Jesus. He's coming to get his church, which is his bride, that is without spot and wrinkle and worthy of marrying the Son of the King of the universe. He won't just marry anybody. To be the wife of the king's son, you have to have certain attributes and qualifications, because you can't just go in and marry him because you want to. So what we realize is that that dragon was angry with the woman, because we are in the last days. That's going to finish his work, and they are going to be reflective of the original people that were on the earth that God has chosen to be his own. The characteristics of ancient Israel are no different than the characteristics of his people right from the beginning, that Adam, the characteristics that he had, that Seth had, that Methuselah had, that Enoch had, and on down through the lineages. And then he had a group of 12 tribes, and they were supposedly had this criteria. And then we move down to the last remnant. And what is the remnant, ladies? That's so, you know, it's the last piece of the boat of cloth, isn't that right? But it should look just like the original piece, isn't that right? Yeah, there's no difference. It's not going to be a different pattern, a different texture. It's going to be the same thing. The only thing that distinguishes this group of people is that they are the last. When he went to make war with the remnant of her seed, Satan himself is telling you that this is the last group of people. By the word remnant, he's letting you know that there will be no others coming. This is it. So if there's any question as to whether we're in the last days, look at the language. The language will tell you that we are in the last days, friends. We are the remnant. We're the last piece of that group of people that God has called to honor him and to promote his gospel. We're the last group that God will have on this earth. And the message he has given us is an eternal message. And look at the characteristics of that eternal message, friends. They're going to be what? Keep the commandments of God. But friend, I wasn't born under a rock. I know that the commandments have not been done away with, because every day on my news, they're chasing people for killing somebody. If the commandments have been done away with, leave the person alone. They haven't broken any laws. They're chasing people for stealing something. The only part of that commandment that they don't like is the part that talks about honoring God. The part that honors God, they don't like that part. And then there are some that will try to tell me you can keep all of them except one, and that's the one that pertains to the Sabbath day. That's been nailed to the cross. Well, of all the ones that are there, that's the one that hasn't been nailed to the cross, because the Sabbath day is symbolic of the creation of the earth. And friend, all of these other ones will go away, but the earth will still remain. It will be the last representative vision, the word I'm looking for is not there. What is the last representative piece of this whole puzzle that says that this is the God that created everything. His commandments are still binding. He's still creator and God of all. He is still the judge in the last days. And it tells us that his testimony, his witness, is going to be by Jesus Christ, and it's going to go through the church, through this remnant. And it tells us in Revelation 19:10 that witness is the spirit of prophecy. We're talking about prophecy today. So it tells me here in these couple of scriptures here that God has a church, and it's the last piece. This is the last message. And in that last message is going to be a reminder of the commandments of God, that there are 10 commandments and God still holds you accountable for them, and that God is going to witness to the world before he comes, and his witness to the world is going to be through prophecy. That's what that tells me. So let's see what we have to say here. The powers of Satan are working ferociously because he knows he has but a little time. Is that right? Yeah. He knows he has but a little time. Revelation, see, this church was founded in when? I mean, it came into existence through the experience of 1844, and it got its name in 1863. But I'm saying from that point to this, God has had in place his last day people carrying the last day message. We've been carrying this message for over 150 years. So if we were close then, we're really close now. And you can see that by the confusion. I'm astounded. I hate to turn on the TV now, because I tell my wife, I'll be so glad when this election garbage is over. It's an amazing thing how people can become in order to gain what they want. And they're digging up things on one another and trying to tear down one another. It is just horrible. But on top of all of that is the confusion of the religious world. I heard a woman the other day on the news, she claims to be an evangelical, and she said that because all of this womanizing and everything is coming out, and in the news, she says, oh, I'm changing my vote, and I'm going to vote for that person. And I'm thinking, really? And you're supposed to be a Christian? And finally, I heard somebody said, another lady they interviewed came on right behind her and said that is absolutely crazy. She said, this man is not even a Christian, and I can't even tell that he loves God. Why is the church trying to vote for him? I wanted to jump through the TV and just hug her because that was the first person I heard that said anything that made sense. People are blinded by the emotional charisma of people, and they will vote for him even though he represents nothing. And friend, that's what's going to happen in the last days, because the beast and the Antichrist are going to get together when they shouldn't have anything in common. But because of the blindness of people, they're going to go and join forces with this power, and they are at opposite ends. Friend, it's amazing, the blindness of this world. But this is what we're living in today. Revelation 19:10, as we have already alluded, tells us that the spirit of prophecy, the testimony of Jesus, is the spirit of prophecy. Isn't that right? In the Greek, this phrase simply means that Jesus is witnessing to the church through the medium of prophecy. That's what that term means. That Jesus is, the testimony of Jesus Christ is that Christ is witnessing to the church through the medium of prophecy. Prophecy is a miracle of knowledge. It describes or represents something future, beyond the power of human ability to discern or to calculate. It is the highest evidence that can be given of supernatural communion with the deity and of the truth of a revelation from God. Now, friend, if that's true, and I believe it is, I wouldn't put it here, then if you are the institution in the last days, that remnant with that potential or with that power, that presence, that says something very special about you, because it says that you are possessing the highest evidence that can be given to humanity of a supernatural communion with deity. Nobody else has it. You have it. And if you despise it and don't want it anymore and want to walk away from it and want to become like those who don't have it, then, friend, you have a terrible situation going on in your life, and you can look for retribution from God, and it will not be friendly. No, for real. Isaiah 46, 9 and 10 says, "Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is none else. I am God and there is none like me. I declare the end from the beginning and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure." Now, if God says that, and then there's a prophet in your midst that's also carrying the same message, then that means they're communicating with one another. Isn't that right? From the earliest of the inspired records, the writings of Moses, down to the last book of the Old Testament, the chief object of the prophetic word was to describe the advent and character of the Savior of mankind, the nature of his work, and the ultimate triumph of his kingdom over opposition. This is what prophecy is about. It's telling what's coming with exactness, but what's coming symbolizes the work of Christ and his coming and the finishing of his kingdom. Examples of this, look at Jude 14. Jude 14 and 15. If you have your Bible, and I hope you do. Jude 14 and 15. Jude 14 and 15. I have a lot to share, so I'm going to move right along. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam. Where was he? Seventh from Adam. That's quite a long time ago, isn't that right? He was seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, "Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed and of all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him." And so we recognize here that Jude, this in Jude, Enoch, the seventh from Adam, is prophesying the second coming of Christ. That's what prophecy does. That message has been in the earth at least, and I know it's before that because Adam preached it also, but it has been in the earth at least since Enoch. So why is it that we don't know it? Why is it that the world is oblivious to the fact that there is a God and his son is coming soon to judge this world? It's the effectiveness of the warfare of the enemy. I'm not going to read all of those. You can read Isaiah 53, but it just talks about Christ when he came to this earth, how he was treated by mankind. There are many precious truths contained in the word of God, but in this day and hour, it is present truth, truth for the here and now that the world desperately needs. This is what we need, friends, and I hope that's what you're getting. I believe so from this pulpit here that you're getting that. Now, I don't know where else you go, but you need to be here to get what's going to prepare you to meet Jesus. You understand? Now, we can go all these other places and rock and roll and do what you want to do, but, friend, that's not going to prepare you to meet Christ. Christ is coming for a distinctive people. And if you don't possess that distinctiveness, you will not meet him in peace. Just like I'm talking about prophecy, that has also been in the earth since the beginning. It has also been in the earth, friend. And so there's no reason for humanity. Why do we in churches now, and I'm not talking about society at large, because they don't even love God, but those in the church should know how exacting and how distinctive God is. He's not a mamby-pamby God with a broad. What does it say in Matthew 7? Straight is the gate, narrow is the way that leads to eternal life, and few there be that find it. Friends, straight means difficult, austere. It doesn't mean without curve. That's not the straight. It's not S-T-R-A-I-G-H-T. It's S-T-R-A-I-T. And so Jesus is telling us right there that I'm a difficult God. To come into my kingdom means you got to straighten up and you have to walk circumspectly. You can't just wander in doing whatever and think at the end of the day I'm just going to fall all over you. He spoke. The spirit of prophecy tells us that God will put a tongue in a rock to get praise if you don't give it to him. He's not going to just accept you. He bent down and made a man once. Can he do it again? Is God starving for company that he's just going to invite more Satans into the kingdom? The one that was in there, he kicked him out, and he's not coming back again. Nahum 1:9 says, this affliction shall not rise up a second time. And God said that ahead of time. Friend, we are in the last day. This is no time to go where you feel like you ought to go. The mind of Christ should be in us. In other words, and I'm going to preach a sermon on this one day. I hope you're here to hear it. We need to realize that what I do and say has to be the result of Christ living in me. My will is no longer relevant. Why do I eat like I eat? Because God said eat that way. Because I used to like shrimp. I still have me a big fat shrimp on my plate. If God didn't say stop eating it and the mind of Christ led me to stop eating it, I'm not doing my will. I'm doing his will because it's his mind that's in me. And all through my life, stuff drops off because they were my desire, but they're not his desire. And all along the way, he's shaping me and molding me to walk as he walks. By me obeying his word and allowing his word become my counselors. Friend, we need the truth for the here and now. And through his chosen servants on this earth, especially in these last days that we're living in, God has used the prophetic gift to send present truth warnings and reproofs is more than just warnings, it's reproofs to his people in every generation without wavering. There's no shadow of turning within God. Without wavering, he has raised up in these last days of humanity's probation a prophet with warnings and reproofs to alert the world to certain things. One, to the fast approach of this earth's end of this earth's probation. It's almost up. Now, the question you need to ask yourself, my friend, however old you are, however long you've been in the message, that if it's taken me this long to get to this state of righteousness, and I have to have way more righteousness than this to get into the kingdom, can I, in the time that's left, either in my lifetime or the coming of Jesus, can I get there and it's taken me this long to get to here? Did you understand what I just said? If it's taken me this long to get to this mediocre condition that I'm in, can I in fact become like Jesus in the time that's left? That's what the true Christian ought to be thinking about instead of all this foolishness. Don't you know, my friend? And friend, I'm not smart by any means, but I do pay attention. My mother told me I had mother's wit. You may not even know what that means, but it means common sense. And don't you know that I know that in a time of the sanctuary, and friend, forgive me, I may have to make two messages out of this. In the time of the sanctuary, which we as Seventh-day Adventists know that we're in. The time of the sanctuary says that during the time of the judgment, which we're in, the antitypical day of the judgment right now, that the people should have been afflicting their soul, they should have been in prayer, they should have been pleading that God, when he come to their name, would find them worthy to inherit eternal life and not be cut off. That's the condition that we're in right now. And don't you think that I recognize that when guitars and drums and celebration and everything come into the church, it's a deception of the devil because he's trying to get your mind off of what you ought to be doing. He knows we are but a short time. And he has deceived our people into playing this silly game. You can't hear the voice of God because he doesn't scream. He speaks in a small voice because he says, if you really want to hear me, be quiet and know that I am God. If you don't be quiet, you never hear him. What has Satan said? Oh, rev it up, rev it up. Get louder, get louder. Shout, jump some pews, do all this stuff. Have a good time in the Lord. And nowhere in this Bible did God tell me to come to the house of God and have a good time. Because having a good time caters to my carnal nature, which I'm supposed to be killing. It's supposed to be dead. If I leave this earth with this nature, I'm doomed. And Satan wants you to do that. He wants you to play your probation out in this nonsense so that at the end of the day, you have nothing. Friend, this is no time for game. Your salvation's on the line. You need to make some serious decisions. And I don't care. I left my whole family and did not care. I love my family. But friend, when it comes down to serving Jesus, I don't play games. I turn against family, friend. I walk this earth by myself. I don't even care. I've never needed a crowd to be happy. And you better make up your mind to be like that and stop wandering around trying to be filled with all this nonsense that the world. Friend, don't you know broad is the way and wide is the gate that leads to destruction, and many there are that go in thereat. If you run around here doing what everybody else is doing, you're lost. You're on the lost road. All of these churches are doing it. You're lost if you try to do that stuff. Friend, Jesus is coming soon. Our probation is ending. It'll either end when you die or end when he comes. Either way, both are coming soon. At our ages, we don't have much time left. The prophet also is telling us that Satan is cleverly disguising his warfare against God and humanity with the intent to become God of this earth. He's trying to enslave all of its inhabitants while endeavoring to destroy God's church and all godliness from the earth. That's what Satan is trying to do. He wants to be God of this earth. Job chapter 1 tells you that. He appeared at the meeting God called for his son. And he's talking about, I walk up and down, to and fro in the earth. He's trying to tell God that I'm the man down there. I'm in control. And true enough, he deceived the one that God had given the authority to. And in any warfare, if I defeat you, I own what you have. He defeated the head of this earth. And now he's the man down here. And Jesus came and died on an old rugged cross to take it back. You're no longer the man down there, Satan. So he's recognizing that. So he said, okay, what I'm going to do, I'm going to tear up as much I can. I'm going to tear down every life I can. I'm going to go and try to drag as many into hell with me as I can, because he knows where he's going. The question is, where are we going? We're sitting in the balance, friend. We can go to heaven or hell. We can make our choice. This prophet is telling us that the soon return of Jesus is near. He's coming to destroy sin, and he's coming to destroy Satan's plans, and he's coming to destroy Satan himself. Now, I know this is a competitive world. I used to be into sports and all that. I'm not anymore, because I realize that God is not a competitor. But what I do recognize is that this world, when I look at this world, everybody likes a winner, don't they? I kind of looked at the response to the Royals this year. They were hooping and hollering and lifting them up. They would have made them gods if they could have. But this year it went away quietly. And I told my wife, I said, why aren't they lifting them up the same way? They're your team. Why don't you love them as much? No, they weren't winners. We love winners. You should lift them up the same way you did last year. They're your team. The execution of God's final judgment is coming upon the inhabitants of this world. It is nearing its completion, friend. He's right now separating those that follow Satan from those that follow God. And how does he know? By the exercise of our will. We demonstrate through our will who we follow. We follow him by exercising our willpower on his behalf, or we follow Satan by, and let me tell you something, you don't even have to exercise your willpower on Satan's behalf, just don't exercise it on God's behalf, and you automatically end up in the other category. He's letting us know, though, that there's a loving Savior is coming soon. He does not desire that anyone be lost. His end time warning messages to humanity are messages of love, friend, because he wants us to be saved. Messages that are designed to acquaint humanity with himself and with the holiness of God, to let us know what it means to be saved. I was with a gentleman not just a couple of days ago, and he's telling me, he didn't know who I was, but he's telling me that he's a Christian. I said, okay, I don't question anybody's commitment, but the Bible tells me that you can judge a tree by the fruit. And you've heard me say, he didn't say get down and dig around the roots and try to figure out what tree it is. He said just look at the fruit. If it's an oak tree and it has apples on it, you need to just walk away. You don't have to go figure out why. Because if you figure out why, you may get ensnared. There's something wrong with that tree. Don't eat the fruit. Don't stand there and stare at it. Get away from it. This brother was telling me that he was a Christian, but he had this music on. So I'm listening to it, and I'm thinking, okay, I wish you'd turn it off, but I didn't say it. I'm just thinking it. Then he cursed a few times in the midst of our conversation. I'm saying, okay. Now, I'm not judging this brother, but I'm judging somewhere along the line that he's got an instruction and a comfort zone that said, this is okay. Now, I guess I'm a hard taskmaster because my issue is with the preachers. My issue is with the preachers. Somewhere along the line, you're not preaching the right thing. I saw not too long ago on TV, I'm not going to call any names, don't try to avoid to, but I heard this noise, and I looked to see what it was, and it was this preacher running back and forth across the stage saying something about come and get your money or your blessing or something. And the people were screaming and whooping because they caught up in this fervor, and they're running up throwing money on the stage. And then after I stood there for a while, I realized what was going on. He's running on top of the money, saying, come and get your blessing. And I'm thinking to myself, why is it that you're the leader of the church, I have to bring you the money so you can get the blessing when you're supposed to be connected with God? You're supposed to be showing me how to get the blessing without me giving you mine. I told my wife, I said, I'd like to find a member of his congregation. And I would say, the next time he tell you to come and get your blessing, pull a bag out of your purse and go up there and start collecting your blessing and see what happens. You'll get cursed. You'll get beat up right there in the middle of the church. Man, it's time that we stop being foolish. It's time. It is ignorance, man, for me to take my money that I can barely make my bills with and come and give it to you to make your payment on your Learjet. And to think that I'm getting a blessing. Won't you sit down and count how many you've gotten since you started this process? Maybe that is your blessing that God gave you and you keep giving it away. Am I the only one in the world with common sense? I know it's an old thing, and I'm old enough to have it. Maybe you young people never heard of it, but I think it's still in the earth. Friend, with a sense of urgency, God's end-time messengers are admonished to go into the ends of the world and preach these truths, presenting to the world that they have a friend and Savior in Jesus. Make the truth plain and baptize those that believe into the family and service of God. Friend, if we don't believe the message, how can we go out with a sense of urgency and preach the message? When we come to the reality that our whole existence in this church is to give this message to somebody else, then we'll stop trying to be a church. I've been telling congregations for years, friend, we ought to get these pews out of here because we were formed as a movement. And somewhere along the line, we decided to become a church so we can come and sit and have a message, hear some good music, go home and eat and do whatever. God didn't call us to do that. We don't even need these things. We should come in here, pray, get some strength, and go out and do the work that God has called, especially now since we're in the last of the last days. But you won't do it if you don't believe it. God has given us this work to do. We are to go into the world in the midst of opposing influences and opposing doctrines. We're supposed to go into the world and by the word and example seek to convert mankind from error to truth. Satan's warfare against the kingdom of God has filled churches and the world at large with unnumbered lies and errors that are generally believed to be truth. Depending largely on traditions, Satan cleverly works through humanity both in and out of the churches to introduce errors and lies as if they were truth. And this is the diet that most of our people are getting. And when I say RP, I'm not just talking about Adventists. I'm talking about humanity. Friend, I'm a member of the family of humanity. You don't have to be a member of this church to hurt me. When you get hurt out there, I hurt. Because if it will happen to you, it won't be long before it will happen to me. Friend, in the world that God lives, no lie is of the truth. You can never, and I don't care how much you do, you cannot use a lie anyway. And I don't care if it comes from the highest preacher with the biggest congregation on TV to the one with three members. It doesn't even matter. You cannot use a lie and represent God. Lie, and it's all a lie. You can also have 1% lie and 99% truth, and it's all a lie. Friend, you can't be sitting under these doctrines that aren't truth. God doesn't use lies to promote his ministry. How long are we going to sit with the devil and worship with the devil and party with the devil? I came out of a church one day. They had a celebration service, and somebody that was with me looked back, and they saw demons coming out of that church, laughing and fellowshipping with the people. Spirit of prophecy tells us that when you worship in that atmosphere, you worship with demons. And I learned a long time ago that when we talk about tongues and everything, that it's not just babbling. They said that you get stroked. The devil is stroking them, and they feel, that's why they feel like, this feeling is so glorious. It must be coming from the Lord. Don't you know that this worship service, you're getting stroked? Don't you know that? There are many voices in the world saying they have the truth. But Christ says in John 17:17 that God's word is truth. He says in Isaiah 8:20, if they speak not according to this word, this truth, that's because there's no light in them, no truth in them. In Matthew 4:4, he said that man must not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. In other words, man must live by 100% truth. That's what God said. And friend, if you're planning on approaching the throne of God having lived by 99% truth and 1% error, you're in trouble. You're in serious trouble. And the interesting thing about it is that when you find that out, there's no recourse. There's no do-over. God's prophets and ministers will speak what God tells them to speak. A thus says the Lord, 100% of the truth, 100% of the time. God's truth can never be explained or understood by using lies or errors. The test of a true prophet is the fulfillment of their prophecies. You want to know if you have a true prophet in your midst? What do they say? And if thou say in thine heart, how shall we know the word which the Lord has not spoken? Answer, when a prophet speaketh in the name of the Lord, if the thing follow not, nor come to pass, it is what? The thing not, it, that is the thing which the Lord hath not spoken, but the prophet has spoken it presumptuously. 2 Chronicles 20:20, believe the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophets, so shall ye prosper. And surely the Lord God will do nothing but reveal his secrets to his servants the prophets. Amos 3:7. So God has instituted the prophet. God put the prophet in the church. God identified the prophet. God even named the prophet. He gave him that name. And then God puts his word in their mouth to give to the people. A prophet is an instrument used by God, carefully chosen. The gift of prophecy was manifested in the church during the Jewish dispensation. It's always been there. It disappeared about the fourth century because of the corrupt state of the church. towards the close of the Jewish dispensation. The Old Testament closed in prophetic silence. And then all of a sudden, who broke that silence? John the Baptist broke that silence. It reappeared in the New Testament to usher in the Messiah. In Luke 1:67, Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, prophesied. In Luke 2:38, Anna, the prophetess, spake of him through prophecy. In Luke 2:32, Simeon spoke in prophecy. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel. He saw the child of Jesus Christ. In John 1:29, there was no greater prophet than John who ushered in Christ. The Christian age commenced with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. So again, God brings the spirit of prophecy back into the church, doesn't he? You can't have the Holy Spirit at Pentecost and not have prophecy. And a great variety of spiritual gifts were manifested among the believers. Because of the great apostasy during the 4th and 18th century, this is the Dark Ages, these gifts have rarely been manifested. See, God doesn't leave prophets where there's no truth. Dark Ages were purely demonic. Purely demonic. The only glimmers of truth that you had were the reformers. And so here, these gifts have rarely been manifested, and this is probably the reason why professed Christians generally believe that these gifts were limited to the period of the early apostolic church. But it was more the errors and unbelief of the church during the Middle Ages that caused the gifts to cease. Now in the end of the world, in this generation of perilous times, with its lying wonders, miracles, and false prophets, God has once again brought to his church the prophetic gift. It is to last until when? Second coming. It won't go away again. Because this is the remnant. This is the end. This is the last. So the spirit of prophecy that's in the church now is for the entire rest of Earth's history. Amen? Speaking to the woman at the well and to the people today, Jesus says, ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. Now, what does that say to you, friends? It says that Jesus, God the Father, and the Son have been in charge of this whole plan of salvation from the beginning. It was God that named the Lamb the Lamb. It was God that decided that the Lamb was to be the sacrifice. It was God that decided that the blood of the Lamb he was willing to use to forgive the sins of humanity. It was God who identified what worship was. Friend, we were a lump of clay in the earth. We didn't know anything. And this world who's trying to use evolution and all this other nonsense to try to do away with God is nothing but the work of Satan. Because remember, Satan came in the Garden of Eden and he's been here ever since fighting against God. But he can't deny it. That's why the Ten Commandments are so important, if the people will embrace them. Because the Ten Commandments said that God created the heaven and the earth, the sea and all that is in them. And when I go back to my Bible, I see that on the first day, I said, ooh, that's interesting. We still call it a day. Do we call it a day today? Who said it first, God? God called it a day. I would have called it something else, maybe. God said it's a day. 6,000 plus years later, we still call it a day. We still call it night. We still call it sun. We still call it moon. Friend, the devil will deceive you if you allow him. But really what he does is just make us sound ignorant. You're going to sit here and use the word of God to deny that there is a God. That's crazy. And we're not wise. God is telling us here that the salvation that he formed and gave to Israel is still the same formula that he's using all the way down, because God doesn't change. He He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. His mind is so masterful that he can create something in day two of creation, and it'd be true in day 6050. God is saying, what I gave the Jews, I gave them the plan of salvation, and it has not changed. It is good for them and for you. For those of you who are trying to give away the gospel because it's the Jews of the Old Testament to the Jews, everything to the Jews, friend, you might be reminded that the only people in heaven right now are the Jews. The so-called Jews. Enoch wasn't named a Jew, but he came out of that lineage. You might want to be reminded of that. And you might want to be reminded that if this salvation that God gave the Jews got them there, might it not get us there? But you can't go ignorantly without wisdom, friend. We have a zeal without knowledge. That's dangerous. Otherwise, you'll run out and try to get you a lamb and try to slay it, and then you'll be denying the lamb that hung on the cross. You got to know what you're doing. But the principles have not changed. But the hour cometh and now is, Jesus said. These are the words of Christ. When the true worshipers shall worship the Father in what? Spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. The Spirit means the Holy Spirit. Truth means this word is truth. 100% the word. The word will bring out the true Holy Spirit, not a false spirit. I remember when my wife and I started searching for a church to go back to. I was raised in the Baptist church, and so was she. And we said, well, I wonder what other church. I'd never been to another church. I didn't know what they did. I said, let's go see what some of these other churches are doing. And we went to some churches, friend, that were downright frightening. The people were leaping the pews and jumping and carrying on and up there, you know. And I'm thinking, whoa. And it was loud, and I don't like loud. Because if there's nothing else that I recognize about the Bible said, let the house of God keep silent. In other words, if you really thought that when you walked in here, Jesus was standing here, whose very presence would consume you with a thought, whose holiness is magnificent. If you really thought you were walking into his presence, you'd close your mouth. Because you know I don't have anything to say. You drop your head, fall on your knees, and realize that you are the most miserable being on earth because this is the God of heaven. It's a far cry, friend, from some of these churches. You play jazz when you walk in the door. I used to be a whirling. I knew where I loved jazz. I love jazz. I had just about every album you could imagine. I know it when I hear it. And to stand boldly and play it in the church, you telling me that this is no longer the church of God. And if you're silly enough to walk in that door and sit on that pew, shame on you. James Brown and Miles Davis and God have nothing in common. I come from the West Coast, friend, and out there we got pastors that invite you into their car and they'll pop in a little Miles Davis or John Coltrane, some of you may not even know who that is, and ride down the street grooving on. And I'm thinking, would you pull this car over and let me out of here before God blow you out of the universe? You're a foolish man. And friend, I'm not going to hell for anyone. If I go, it's because I chose to go. But I will not let your foolishness take me where I don't want to go. And I'm very well able to have church at my house. Lock all of you out. Don't answer no doorbell. You understand what I'm saying? I'll lock every one of you out. It's me and Jesus in here. I don't need a crowd, friend. You better stop seeking one. Therefore, as it was in ancient Israel, so it is in spiritual Israel. Today, remember, God never changes. He never changes. So as it was in ancient Israel, so it will be in spiritual Israel. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Friend, this is foundation. This is bedrock truth. There are some truths in the Bible that you can always stand on. He's the same yesterday and forever, even if you're having a wonderful time or if you're having the worst day of your life. He is still God. And he doesn't change. That's bedrock, friend. That's where you stand. When the world beats you up and you can hardly get on your feet, you crawl back to this passage and stand there until you get some strength to move forward again. The Word of God, the law of God, seven-day Sabbath, prophetic gifts, the health message, the sanctuary message, the righteousness by faith, judgment hour, the ambassadors with a national message, the high priest in the sanctuary, Pentecostal experience, early and latter rain. You look forward to the coming of Christ. Tithe and offering. Maybe I ought to repeat that one. Is that right, Brother DJ? Maybe I ought to repeat the tithes and offering. You people keep giving God this little piddly amount and you expect a window blessing. God doesn't open a window for piddlies. He won't even bother to walk across the room and put his hand on the window. Your faith is where your money is. If you care about the house of God and the work of God, then your money ought to say so. Followers suffered for the name of Christ. Friend, these are the experiences of ancient Israel. And these are the experiences of modern Israel. If you find a church or a people that believes all of this, not 99%, all of it, and are going through all of it, then you found God's people on this earth. You have found the remnant. Because he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Salvation is of the Jews. If this is what God led the Jews to do, then you better believe that modern Israel will be led to do the same thing. The remnant of God's people existing amid the signs and wonders that usher in the great and terrible day of the Lord is the remnant of the seed of the woman spoken of in Revelation 12, verse 17. The remnant of the gospel church will have all the gifts of the Spirit, and war will be waged against the remnant because they keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Friend, have you felt the heat yet? If you haven't felt the heat, maybe you're not exhibiting this very clearly. I feel it in my own family when I try to talk to them. They think I'm a crazy man, but that's okay. That's okay. Because a friend of mine, I know a judgment day is coming. And God doesn't necessarily have to reveal it to you in all its glory, because then you'll change because you're scared. God wants you to change because you're convinced of the truth. Because as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. A man changed against his will by an opinion is of the same opinion still. Isn't that what they say? Yeah. The Seventh-day Adventist Church believes that by divine revelation, that it has been organized by God in these last days of earth's probation to give final warning messages to a perishing world, serving as God's remnant church and distinguished by the manifestation of the gift of prophecy in its midst. the testimony of Jesus Christ, which is the witness of Jesus, is believed to be through the medium of prophetic gift as manifested in Ellen G. White. Ellen G. White was born 1827, died 1915. During her lifetime, she wrote more than 5,000 periodicals and 40 books. She is the most translated woman writer in the entire history of literature. Did you hear that? A woman with a third grade education has written over 40 books, 5,000 articles, the most translated. And even today, one of her books is sitting in the Library of Congress as the best book ever to talk about the life of Jesus. Throw away if you want to, but it'll be at your own loss. Friend, this is not rocket science, but it does require some meditation and thought. She's the most translated author of any gender, male or female. She's the most translated American author. Her life-changing masterpiece on successful Christian living, Steps to Christ, has been published in more than 140 languages. Her writing covers a broad range of subjects. With a third grade education, who would have given her that information? Friend, let me just stop right here, because I hear brilliant men, some with two PhDs, talk about Ellen White is not that inspired. She's not doctrinal and all these terms they're throwing out. And I tell my wife, I say, what these men, what Satan failed to tell them is that when she was in her prophetic state, it was the Holy Spirit speaking, and the Holy Spirit is smarter than all you PhDs. No, you don't understand because you're not in tune to God. It wasn't a third grade education writing 40 books. It was God writing 40 books. Her writings cover a broad range of subjects, including religion, education, social relationship, evangelism, prophecy, publishing, nutrition, and management. Seventh-day Adventists believe she was appointed by God as a special messenger to draw the world's attention to the Holy Scriptures and help prepare people for Christ's second advent or his second coming. From the time that she was 17 years old until she died at the age of 70, God gave her approximately 2,000 visions and dreams. The visions varied in length from less than a minute to nearly 4 hours. The knowledge and counsel received through these relations, she wrote out to be shared with others. Thus, her special writings are accepted by Seventh-day Adventists as inspired, and their exceptional quality is also recognized even by the casual non-Adventist reader. Seventh-day Adventists believe her writings are not a substitute for Scripture. They cannot be placed on the same level as the Word of God. Yet, as she herself noted, the fact that God has revealed his will to men through his Word has not rendered needless the continued presence and guidance of the Holy Spirit. On the contrary, the Spirit was promised by our Savior to open the Word to his servants, to illuminate and apply its teachings. This came out of Great Controversy, page 7. Let's look at some facts concerning what a prophet is all about. What is the prophetic gift? I'm not going to read all these scriptures, but I will read what they mean. Deuteronomy 18, 21 and 22 tells us that a true prophet of the Lord predicts that which does come to pass. And if the prophet's predictions fail, they are exposed as not from God. If you're in a church that said that Jesus was coming in New York in 18-something and he didn't come, you ought to be heading for the exit. Numbers 12, 6. A true prophet of the Lord will receive visions and or dreams from the Lord. Numbers 24:16, when in vision, a true prophet will fall into a trance and their eyes will be open. And so far, friend, Ellen White has met all of these requirements. We don't just accept anybody to walk in and say, I'm a prophet. No. You have to demonstrate, because the Bible is the textbook for the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And when you meet the requirements in this textbook, then we will acknowledge what God has made you. Amen? Daniel 10:17, the true prophet in vision will collapse with absolutely no strength in them. When in vision, a true prophet will not breathe. The word inspiration simply means God breathed. Therefore, since the Almighty is breathing through the prophet, communicating his truth, the prophet has no need to breathe. Daniel 10:18, once touched in the vision, the prophet receives supernatural strength. Jeremiah 28:9, a true prophet will be 100% accurate. There is absolutely no margin for error. 2 Peter 1:20, a true prophet never gives their private interpretation. They only share what the Lord reveals. Scripture defines scripture, not man. 1 Corinthians 14:3-4, a true prophet will look to edify, comfort, and uplift the church body by their testimony as well as exhort them. Amen? A true prophet only prophesies in the name of the Lord. They only seek to glorify the Lord. They will never seek to glorify themselves. Never. 2 Peter 1:21. Look at Isaiah 8:20. A true prophet keeps God's law, and he abides by the testimony of the Bible prophets as well. If a prophet does not agree with the Bible prophets or does not keep God's Ten Commandments, they are a false prophet. Well, that eliminates a whole bunch of people, doesn't it? Yeah. Tomorrow, on Sunday, get in your car and drive by all the churches and recognize false prophet, false prophet, false prophet, false prophet, because a true prophet will be doing what God said. God would not introduce the Ten Commandments and go follow the devil. Is this too strong for you? If so, I'll sit down. Okay. Just want to make sure. A true prophet believes and preaches the incarnation of Christ. They will preach Jesus as God who came to earth and put on humanity. And this is important, because even in the Adventist church, we are allowing PhDs to confuse us. God, Jesus came in the nature of Adam after the fall. He came in sinful nature. The Catholic Church and all the others that follow their lead have it wrong. Jesus cannot be tempted in all points as I am if he's still fully God. James tells us God cannot be tempted, neither does he tempt. So if God cannot be tempted, how can he be tempted in all points even as I am unless he came in my nature? It's not rocket science, friend, but you have to think. You have to meditate on the word. You got to let God speak to you. And we have PhDs who are relying on their education to get them through, and they don't understand this. Well, let me go back. A true prophet will show good works and have identifiable fruits of a Christian. They will show what? Abundant biblical fruits. They'll love people. They'll care for the homeless. They'll care for the fatherless. They will clothe. They will feed. They will be Christians. They don't just sit on a high seat and give out prophecy. They come down on the ground and they live. They have heartbreaks. They have their children die. They have sickness. They struggle with sin. They struggle with appetite. They have all of these issues, just like you and I. Amen? Gender makes no difference. A woman or a man can be a prophet. These scriptures tell us so. Age has no difference. There have been young prophets and old. I think when Abraham died, he was still a prophet, wasn't he? He was 175. Performing miracles proves nothing, because Satan can do miracles. So you don't use a miracle to decide who's the prophet from God. Amen? Let's look at some of the gifts in action. In 1902, she, meaning Ellen G. White, warned that the cities around the Bay Area of California would suffer disaster. And recognize this is a short sermon, friends, so it's just a small, piddly amount of things, but there's a whole wealth of stuff that could be written up here. This is what she wrote. She wrote in 1902, not long hence, these cities will suffer under the judgment of God. San Francisco and Oakland are becoming as Sodom and Gomorrah, and the Lord will visit them in wrath. In 1902, she said that. Those who heeded Ellen White's warning left this area and avoided the earthquake in 1906, 4 years later, which devastated the cities mentioned. 1890, when peace was prevalent, she wrote this, the tempest is coming, not peace, the tempest is coming. Now, people in a time of peace will look at that and say, oh, what's she talking about? She must be crazy. We shall see trouble on all sides. Thousands of ships will be hurled into the depths of the sea. Navies will go down and human lives will be sacrificed by the millions. She wrote this in 1890. Again in 1904, she wrote, soon great trouble will arise among nations, troubles that will not cease until Jesus comes. Now it's interesting, she wrote that in 1904. 1913, Woodrow Wilson wrote, we have finally arrived at an age of settled peace and goodwill. But listen to the prophet. Since those prophecies, the world has seen two world wars that we call world wars, but all these other ones were wars too, friend. Take my word for it. Numerous battles and skirmishes. World War I, 1917. Now, when did she write that other statement? The final statement, 1904, Woodrow Wilson in 1913 thought we had met Nirvana. All of a sudden here in 1917, World War I, 1941, World War II, 1950, the Korean War, 1965, the Vietnam War, the Gulf War in 1990, Afghanistan in 2001, Iraq 2003, War on ISIL 2014, and it's going to keep going, and it doesn't look like ISIL is going to stop anytime soon. She said, it will last until Jesus comes. Who do you believe, Woodrow Wilson or the prophet? There's an increase of crime. Light was given, she said, light was given me that the cities would be filled with confusion, violence, and crime, and that these things would increase till the close of this earth's history. Can we look at the news every morning and say she's right? You can't? You're not looking close enough, honey. That's because you haven't gotten that wisdom yet. Grow up a little more, you'll be looking at it and you'll be wanting to turn it off. It's not a day that I turn on the news that is not discouraging. Somebody got killed. Somebody got shot. Somebody, you know, and then they got these two guys on in court. And I thought, you know, the devil will make us dumb. Now, how many people do you know are going to break in and rob a gun shop? No, seriously. He's got guns all on the wall, and I'm going to break in and rob you? I mean, logic would say I'm going to go somewhere where they may not have any guns so that I'm the only one with a gun. And I look and I just shake my head. I say, Lord, the devil's just making us foolish. Our wisdom is just not there because we're blinded by his sophistry. And what we do makes all the sense in the world because we can't see afar off. It's a shame, friend. As far back as when the medical world was unaware of the dangers of tobacco and indeed often prescribed it as a cure or preventative measure against certain lung ailments, she wrote this: "Tobacco is a poison of the most deceitful and malignant kind, having an exciting, then a paralyzing influence upon the nerves of the body. It is all the more dangerous because its effects upon the system are so slow and at first scarcely perceivable. Multitudes have fallen victims to its poisonous influence." Now, she wrote that when the medical profession back in the 1800s didn't even understand. Everybody was smoking. In fact, they said, you know, light up, that'll help your lung condition. There was a time when they wouldn't open the windows and let fresh air in because they thought it would hurt you and inflict you with pneumonia. And they would close down the windows and everything so that the germs remained inside. She had to tell them, raise the windows, let fresh air come in. Let me see, did I read that? Not until 1957 did a committee of scientists appointed by the American Cancer and American Heart Association conclude that smoking was a causative factor in lung cancer. She went on to counsel physicians on how to regard the issue of smoking. She wrote, "The physician should be strictly temperate man." This is a third grade educated woman telling a doctor what he ought to do. Who's speaking, the Holy Spirit or the education? The physician should be strictly temperate, should be a strictly temperate man. The physical ailments of humanity are numberless, and he has to deal with disease in all its varied forms. He knows that much of the suffering he seeks to relieve is the result of intemperance and other forms of selfish indulgence. He is called to attend young men and men in the prime of life and in mature age who have brought disease upon themselves by the use of the narcotic tobacco. Now, she says here that the fact that Ellen White calls tobacco a narcotic was interesting in and of itself, since the narcotic effect of nicotine have only been established in recent times. But she knew it then, because God had told her. What about economic difficulties? Those who hold the reins of government are not able to solve the problems of moral corruption, poverty, pauperism, and increasing crime. They are struggling in vain to place business operations on a more secure basis. If men would give more heed to the teachings of God's word, they would find a solution of the problems that perplex them. This is dealing with trade imbalance, third world nation difficulties, and the national debt. Friend, we keep trying to put people in office that's going to balance the budget and do all these things, but they don't care anything about God. They don't obey God. They will support homosexuality marriages just to get the vote. They will do all kind of things. I look at these guys on TV, and they're just at each other's throat. And you think, man, and I'm going to put you in office for what? Well, somebody has to go in office because the mark of the beast has to come in. Isn't that right? And so what you and I need to be looking for is which one of you guys is going to bring it in? That's what I'm looking at. I'm looking at the character. And saying, okay, which one of you are going to be the one that's going to be used by Rome to bring in the mark of the beast? I'm not looking for salvation through these people. We know too much, friend, to be sitting and watching the news like everybody else. We don't pick up the newspaper like everybody else. We know something. At least we ought to. Angels are now restraining the winds of strife, that they may not blow until the world shall be warned of its coming doom. But a storm is gathering, ready to burst upon the earth, and when God shall bid his angels loose the winds, there will be such a scene of strife as no pen can picture. Do you realize that what you see in the news and in the newspaper today is what the Holy Spirit and the angels hold in the winds? And if it's this bad now, what's going to happen when God said, loose the wind, let them go? When human passion is at a full bore and is open and wide and unrestrained and the devil just has full sway. Satan will then, I'll tell you what's going to happen, Satan will then plunge the inhabitants, that means all of them, of the earth, that means the whole world, not just the United States, the whole world, into one great final trouble. As the angels of God cease to hold in check the fierce winds of human passion, all the elements of strife will be let loose. The whole world will be involved in ruin more terrible than that which came upon Jerusalem of old. Go back and read AD 70, what happened to Jerusalem, and get a sense of what she's referring to there. Here's a man here. He was the general conference president of the Seventh-day Adventist Church from 1901 to 1922, the longest serving there was. He wrote a couple of books, Christ Our Righteousness and the Abiding Gift of Prophecy. I want to take a few clips out of the book Abiding Gift of Prophecy as he talked about Ellen White. They were getting ready to go to a meeting in Oakland, California in 1903. He was the general conference president. And there were some issues going on there, and the pressure was up on him, and he felt it very seriously. And this is on his deathbed, he's given his account of what happened. He's being interviewed just a few hours before he died. He said, I struggled unto death, crying aloud, and I nearly reproached the Lord for not giving me some sign, some evidence of my acceptance, and his support of me in the awful battle that was before me. He was getting ready to go into this meeting, some serious issues. He said, during this struggle, he prostrated himself on the floor, clutching, as it were, at the floorboards as he agonized with God. All night, he wrestled with the Lord. Then, he reported, as the morning sun burst into the room, as distinctly as if audibly spoken, the words burned into my mind as a message from God. If you will stand by my servant until her, talking about Ellen White, until her sun sets in a bright sky, I will stand by you to the last hour of the conflict. Already the church was starting to doubt her. Some were supporting her, others were talking against her and separating themselves from her, not believing that the messages she sent were from God. He goes on to say, I couldn't talk anymore with God. I was overcome. And although I have made mistakes, God has stood by me. And I have never repudiated that woman nor questioned her loyalty to my knowledge. From that night to this. Oh, that was a happy experience to me, and it bound me up with the greatest character, meaning Ellen White, that has lived in this dispensation. I was deeply impressed that I must be as true as a needle to the pole to the counsels of the spirit of prophecy, that I must stand loyally by the Lord's servant, upholding her hand and leading this denomination to recognize and appreciate her heaven-sent gift. I then made my solemn promise to the Lord that I would be true to his cause, that I would do all in my power to prevent anything from arising in this denomination to dim the glory of the priceless gift and of the Lord's servant who had exercised this gift for so many years. That's what he felt on his deathbed. The experience, Elder Daniel said, marked the beginning of an important era of wholehearted acceptance of the spirit of prophecy. Let's look at what she says. Sometimes the best evidence of a prophet is what comes out of their mouth. I'm about to finish. Just hold on. Let the testimonies be judged by their fruits. What is the spirit of their teachings? What has been the result of their influence? This is what she's asking the church. All who desire to do so can acquaint themselves with the fruits of these visions. For 17 years, God has seen fit to let them survive and strengthen against the opposition of Satan's forces and the influence of human agencies that have aided Satan in his work. God is either teaching his church, reproving their wrongs, and strengthening their faith, or he is not. Remember, that's the work of the prophet. Isn't that right? This work is of God, or it is not. God does nothing in partnership with Satan. My work bears the stamp of God or the stamp of the enemy. There is no halfway work in the matter. The testimonies are of the Spirit of God or they are of the devil. Now, how many prophets do you know that would invite people to come in and analyze, evaluate? You look at it and see. A false prophet wouldn't call you into for that kind of evaluation. But a prophet that knows that they stand where God placed them will. They have nothing to fear. Nothing to fear. When I go and talk to people about the Word of God, I know that if the Holy Spirit is speaking through me and the Holy Spirit is in that person, I don't have to convince them. The Holy Spirit will confirm what I'm saying. You understand what I'm saying? I don't have to try to force anything. As the Lord has manifested himself through the spirit of prophecy, past, present, and future have passed before me. I have been shown faces that I have never seen, and years afterwards I knew them when I saw them. I have been aroused from my sleep with a vivid sense of subjects previously presented to my mind, and I have written at midnight letters that have gone across the continent and arriving at a crisis have saved great disaster to the cause of God. This has been my work for many years. A power has impelled me to reprove and to rebuke wrongs that I had not thought of. Is this work of the last 36 years from above or from beneath? It is Satan's plan to weaken the faith of God's people in my writings, the testimonies. Satan knows how to make his attack. He works upon the minds to excite jealousy and dissatisfaction toward those at the head of the work. The gifts are next to be questioned. Then, of course, as the gifts are questioned, they will have little weight and instruction given through vision is disregarded. Next will follow skepticism in regard to the vital points of our faith. Pretty soon, we don't even believe the pillars of our faith. Our position is lost. Then doubt as to the Holy Scripture. We don't even believe the Holy Scripture. Do you realize that we have people in the Seventh-day Adventist Church that will tell you they don't believe in the first five books of the Bible? That's a bunch of nonsense. There are subjects to this, friend. This is what's going on right now as I speak. And so next follows skepticism in regard to the vital points of our faith, the pillars of our position, then doubt as to the Holy Scriptures, and then the downward march to perdition. That's where they're headed. There's nothing clever about not believing the Bible. There's nothing clever about throwing away the what you miss is the benefit that they could have given your life, and then you face Jesus at the end of the day. Hell is not funny, friend. Hell is not clever. When the testimonies which were once believed are doubted and given up, Satan knows the deceived ones will not stop at this, and he redoubles his effort till he launches them into open rebellion, which becomes incurable and ends in destruction. By giving place to doubt and unbelief in regard to the Word of God and by cherishing feelings of disgust and cruel jealousies, they are preparing themselves for complete deception. They rise up with bitter feelings against the ones who dare to speak of their errors and reprove their sins. Now, friend, I think that somebody is probably maybe angry with me today. I didn't come to make you angry. But I want it to be written in heaven that I came and did what God called me to do. And that you know. It's always left with the individual to exercise their will to either do or don't do. Don't you know that's the road to salvation is always a moment by moment, day by day, exercising your will on the part of God? How many times do you go to the refrigerator and open it and pull something out? That's a will situation. Friend, do I exercise my will to get this or to get that? God says your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. What you put in it either glorifies me or defiles my temple. So when I reach to get something, that's a fork in the road at which I exercise will. When I decide to go somewhere, I have a fork in the road that I exercise will. When I decide to spend my time doing something, I go to the TV, I exercise will. Or maybe I'll turn it off and pick up the red book that I haven't read. You understand, my friends? The road to salvation is you and I exercising our will on a moment-by-moment basis. You don't have to wonder if you're saved. At the end of the day, friend, if I put one foot in front of the other, I'll end up at that door. All I have to do is make sure the next foot gets in front of the last one. And then the next one gets in front of the other. If I keep putting one foot in front of the other, I'll go somewhere. That's how you get to heaven. You don't have to sit down and anguish over what way down the road, anguish over what am I going to do right now with my willpower. If I keep exercising it properly, God will save me. Amen? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you in the name of Jesus for hearing us today and blessing us and speaking to us, knowing our fears and what makes us tremble, Lord, our doubts. All these things, Lord, we lift up to you. You are our salvation. You are our hope. You are our wisdom. You are our understanding. Lord, there's not a person in here that doesn't want to be saved and live always with you. And Father, we just pray that you would teach us. Take us by the hand. Guide us, Lord. We are children without understanding. Lead us into eternal life. Show us how to exercise our will. Teach us how to pray. Teach us how to live the obedient Christian life. And Father, at the end of the day, we know that a faithful God will do that which is right. Thank you for hearing and answering our prayer today. In Jesus' name, amen.